Hey everybody, how's it going? Happy Tuesday. Tonight we are going to talk about manding. Okay, requesting. It's one of my favorite topics because it really helps students with autism and other complex communication disorders get started in communicating. So I love working on manding, and I have seen so many examples of when we work on manding, it really helps students increase their spontaneous communication. And in some instances, it helps people develop a way to communicate with the world. So that's why I'm so excited about talking about manding and why I'm so excited about doing these Facebook Lives and connecting with all of you. So if you're just joining us, we're talking about manding tonight, how to get students started with communication. And if you're new here, my name is Rose Griffin. I am a speech language pathologist and a board certified behavior analyst. So in the beginning of Facebook Lives that we've been meeting, we've talked about preference assessments, working with students to identify their reinforcers and things that they really like. And we talked about the different verbal operants. So we talked about manding, meaning requesting. We talked about tacting, which means labeling. We talked about interverbals, which could be filling in the blank or answering a question. And we've talked about echoics. So I say something, you say something, and our verbal message is exactly the same. So tonight what we're gonna do is talk about manding. What do we do when we know what a student enjoys and we wanna start working on helping a student increase their ability to communicate with the world or develop their voice, find their voice? So I have a more in-depth webinar on my TPT store called The Power of Manding, Helping Students Find Their Voice. And it's about working with students with autism to help them build a way to communicate with the world. And so manding is where, mands are the first in the language repertoire that's learned by all children. So I have three children of my own who just went to bed, and they are all under the age of 8. So I know a little something. If you're just joining us, we're talking about manding. My kiddos mand a lot. So typical learners mand all the time. If you had a clicker and you clicked mands, they mand mommy, they mand milk, they mand for juice, they mand for ball, they mand for all different types of things. And so manding is how we all start communicating with the world. And when I started learning more about verbal behavior, the verbal behavior approach specifically, it just made sense to me. Wow, yeah, that's right. Typical learners manned all the time. And what doesn't make sense, where there's a disconnect to me just as a provider, is that a lot of the standardized tests that we use in to test students don't always look at manding. Some of them might, but the ones that I was trained on, the ones that I use that are readily available for me, do not look at manding. And so last week we talked about the VB map. So like or comment if you watched last week's session about the VB map. And we talked about how the VB map does look at manding, and it does look at where is your student, are they manding? Can they man for things that are right there? Can they man for items or activities that are not present? And do they need to work more on that skill? So oftentimes I talk about how to start working with a student who maybe doesn't have a functional response form. So when I say functional response form, I mean doesn't have a way to communicate. And so I may call that person an early learner. And what's so sad to me is that oftentimes, if you're joining us now, we're talking about manding and how when I say an early learner, it doesn't just mean somebody who is young in age chronologically. An early learner could be somebody who's 20, somebody who's 18. And I've met students like this who are, for whatever reason, don't have a way to communicate with the world. And then oftentimes what we see, not always, but oftentimes what we see is that if a student hasn't learned a way to communicate with the world, they may develop this functional, it works for them, but it's maladaptive behavior, disruptive behavior that is acting as their way to communicate because they haven't been able to be taught or they haven't learned how to communicate with the world. So that's what we're talking about tonight, how to get started. And so manding is where we start. I do something, I get something. A student mans for cookie, they get a cookie. A student mans for iPad, they get the iPad. And that's how it really works as we lay that foundation down. So if you're just joining us, we're talking about manding, and I'm tuning in and joining you from Ohio. So like or comment and let me know where you're listening from. So tonight, what we're talking about is some of the prerequisites, right? We need to know what a student's reinforcers are. So the most important thing is we have to identify things that the student enjoys. It doesn't just have to be things the student eats. It doesn't have to be activities. It can be a lot of different things. And then we talked about if a student doesn't like things, and this is a lot of the times a student we may encounter, if a student is really limited in what they enjoy, then we could do a preference assessment. And so a preference assessment is gonna give us an idea of all these different potential reinforcers that we could show the student and see if we could motivate the student to want to request these items, or we could use these items as reinforcers through different programming. And so once we know exactly what the student enjoys, I have students, let's see, I worked with a student today who really likes Daniel the Tiger. I worked with a student last week who really liked listening to the Monster Mash. We listened to that and it was reinforcing because they were into it, they were watching it. Or the Minions, that's another big one. So everybody has something different that they like. So once we know what they like, then it gets to be the hard part. Sometimes that's the hard part, okay? And sometimes we're gonna start working on manding even if we haven't been able to identify a lot of different things that the student likes. So if you're just joining us, we're talking about where to get started with manding. The next thing, once we know what a student really enjoys, we want to identify their response form. So when I say response form, I mean, how is the student gonna communicate with the world? Is the student going to use sign language? Is this student going to use picture exchange? Is this student going to use an augmentative device? Is this student a verbal learner, or could they be a verbal learner? Or are we gonna use all those different things? And so that's something that I talk more in depth about in some of the different webinars that I've done for some of the ASHA providers. But you know, we have to look at globally. You know, I had a student before that we thought, oh, okay, student is not talking, student is older, maybe we're gonna use an iPad, but then the student didn't have a really great point. And so we thought, oh, that's not really gonna work. Okay, let's switch to sign language. We can do sign language. Let's work on 3 to 5 signs and their specific signs, and we'll talk about that. And we're gonna try sign language, and then we're gonna work on echoics. Okay, it all kind of goes together. Tonight we're just talking about manding. But what was amazing about this particular student, and I like to share those therapy things, I hope you like to hear about them, because when I go to conferences, I like to hear other people talk about what happens in therapy, because as speech therapists, I think we're on these little islands and we kind of operate alone. But this student, I thought, okay, this is a good candidate for AAC, this is gonna be great, get the iPad, we did Proloquo, all set up, and wasn't going anywhere, right? I'm taking data every session, we're analyzing it, because that's what I do. And we made a decision like, hey, this isn't working. The kid's kind of verbalizing and using sign language, so let's use those. And we're working on manding. And manding has really increased, okay? We just stopped the AAC because it wasn't working for this particular learner. And so what I'm saying with response form, and if you're just tuning in, we're talking about manding, and we're talking about how do we decide on a response form? There's so many different things that go into that. You know, culture, we have to look at the family, parent involvement. We have to make sure that we're making a good choice for the student. Is the student preferring something? We have to really, there's a lot that goes into that. And so, you know, I like sign language. Sometimes I think it's swept under the rug sometimes, but what's nice about sign language is that your hands are right here. They don't have to be plugged in. If they come in, you know, the device comes in, it's on charge. Sometimes you may work places where, you know, it's hard to get the team members to take the iPad out of the bag, or the, you know, the device out of the bag, and there could be barriers. Not to say that that's bad. So what I'm saying is you have to really globally look at it. If you have an AAC specialist in your area, I have one that I work with, I always work with closely with those people. I feel like, hey, I know some stuff about AAC, but I really want to pick the brains of somebody who specializes in that, and that's all they do every day, right? I want to take that person and I want to collaborate with them, and I want to get all that wisdom about Dropbox and, you know, doing your iPad and how to program things and all those different things. So response form. Response form is huge, okay? And that lends itself to the next point, is that no matter what the response form is, you have to make sure that all team members are in the loop, okay? All the team members have to be in the loop. So, you know, I'm sure that you guys have a lot of different team members. I probably work on teams of maybe 10 people. So comment, let me know how many people are on the team that you're working in. So I may be working with a paraprofessional and a board certified behavior analyst, and I'm on the team, an intervention specialist, and maybe somebody from an AAC specialist, and a parent, and maybe an advocate, and all these different people that I've worked with in the past. So sometimes that even can be overwhelming as a speech therapist. You come and sit down at a meeting, you're gonna talk about Manding or whatever your IEP goals, and then it's a team of 15 people, and I don't know, that makes me nervous too. So anyway, so what the important thing is, all team members have to be in the loop. So when I said for the student, like, hey, we're gonna do sign language, this is what we're gonna do, this is my vision, and this is how we're gonna implement it. I did get a little pushback, like, oh, I don't know any sign language. I said, oh, that's okay. There's a website, and I'll put these up in the comments below, www.lifeprint.com. Let me know, like or comment, have you used that website before? It's a really nice website, it's ASL, and it's a person doing sign, but it's static, so, oh, I got a like, okay. It's static, so what I did for this particular learner is I said, okay, copying off, we're gonna use these 3 to 5 signs, and this is what they look like. I went over it with the team members, everybody who's gonna be working with this student, so we were all in the loop. I think the more that I'm a speech therapist, the more I really understand, like, hey, collaboration is key. If I am not collaborating, right, as one of my fellow speech therapists said, speech therapy doesn't happen in a bubble, right? I'm not walking down, getting a student, you know, getting my magic wand out, doing speech therapy, coming back, and then everything's okay. That brings me up to my disclaimer, though. These Facebook Lives I'm just doing for general information, and if you need a speech-language pathologist, you could find a certified one on the ASHA website. Or if you need to find a BCBA that's in your area, you can go to www.bacb.com. I am both, but I'm just here in Ohio, and I just want to give this good information out because I really do believe in disseminating information. So if you're just joining us, we were talking about response forms. So make sure that all team members are in the loop. So, you know, something I've done this year is I've taken videos and I've sent it to different team members because we don't always have time to meet. Or if there's geographical barriers, how can I let somebody know, maybe a parent that can't come in for a meeting because parents work, and, you know, we want them to know, like, hey, we're working on this. Can I take a video and send it to them? That's kind of way the world works now with mobile. That's how we're connecting today. So anyway, make sure that all team members are in the loop. Okay, so we know the reinforcers for a student, or still trying to figure those out. We have talked about a response form. How's a student gonna communicate? We need to make sure all members are in the loop. Okay, now we're gonna work on Manding. So what I'm gonna do in this, today on ABA Speech Live, is just talk about the very couple strategies. There's a couple different strategies that I like to talk about, but I'm just gonna talk about the initial ones. So the first one is prompt mans at first. So if you have a student who really wants to play with a ball, okay, and they're using sign language and they see the ball, you know, they're motivated for the ball, they really want that, you wanna help them. Use a full physical prompt, okay, to shape that if you need to. Or you could just show them the prompt, the sign, if they're using sign, and they could do it after you, and then they would get the ball. So the idea is, we think back to our prompting hierarchy from graduate school, if you're a speech therapist, and, you know, do I need to give a full physical prompt, a partial physical prompt, you know, a model prompt, I call that a gestural prompt, just making sure we're all on the same page, what do those prompts mean, and making sure the team knows that. But you want the learner to know, this is easy, I can do this. Because oftentimes what happens is these students who don't have a response form and they are older, is that they have just learned that communicating is hard. And they're not gonna do it anymore. And it's disheartening. So I love to be the one that comes in there and says, you can do this, we got this, we know what you like, we're gonna work on Manding, and then we're gonna work on other things too, but this is where we're gonna start. So prompt mans at first. That's my step one, very, very important. Step two is make sure that you're prompting for powerful reinforcers. So if a student looks at the ball and they want it and they man for ball, that's great, give them the ball. But if they look at something, you prompt them to request it and then they don't want it, they shouldn't have to have that. Manding's all about being motivated. What is a student motivated for? So I've talked about that today. I had Starbucks this morning. That's what I'm motivated by in the morning. Let me know, did you have Starbucks or Dunkin'? So we have to ask our students at the beginning of every session, what are you motivated for today? What are you into today? Because reinforcement changes, we have to remember that. And that is so very important to remember. Step three is work on specific mans. And we can talk more about that at length, but specific mands meaning I'm going to start with 3 to 5 mands the student enjoys, and I want to make sure that they're specific. So if my student likes Super Y, I'm going to work on Super Y. And if they like cookies, we may work on that. And if they want to take a walk, we may work on that. They like to jump on the trampoline. We're going to do 3 to 5, and we're going to make sure they're specific. We do not want to start with Manding for bathroom, or Manding for please or thank you, or some of those things that I see sometimes. And you know what? These strategies are a combination of things, but are from, I heard Dr. Carbone talk, who's an amazing BCBA with many different outlets where he is providing instruction. And hi there. And he has places in the East Coast, in London, Dubai. And so listening to him talk, and then just my working with students, and the VB map has inspired me. So these are kind of where these strategies come from. So work on specific mands. The idea behind a mand is I say something, I get something. I say something, I get something. So if I say cookie, you know I want cookie. If I say ball, you know that I want ball. If I say more, somebody needs to ask the student more of what, okay? More of what? That's what the student needs to say, okay? So those are my strategies for that right now. So you want to make sure that you prompt mands at first, that you use powerful reinforcement, and that you use specific mands. Those are so very important. So that's all we're gonna talk about today. When you join it next week, we're gonna talk more about manding. If you want to learn more, go to my TPT store at ABA Speech, and I have a webinar there called The Power of Manding, and you can learn more there. Also, make sure to sign up for my freebie every single month. This school year, I'm giving out a freebie. So this month, next month, October 11th, the freebie is all about manding. So strategies for manding. So it will be a nice sheet that you could put up in your classroom, or you could use to guide instruction if the other team members are going to be working on manding. And so my website is www.abaspeech.org. So head over there and sign up from email if you're not already on there. A couple other things I wanted to tell you about. I have a couple things in my TPT store that are new. I have a bootcamp series, so if this is interesting to you, all about manding, I have a 9-part series called ABA Speech Bootcamp, and it is 3 hours of content. If you're a speech language pathologist and you do all the different webinars, you could let me know and I could send you a certificate for continuing maintenance hours. So I wanted to let you know about that, and that's super exciting. I also have a new product that is for a free virtual mini professional development seminar. So if you work with a team of speech language pathologists or special educators, and you meet on a day of the week that I would be available to provide professional development, that includes a free consultation, and I could also talk with your team about what would suit your needs, and I could do that webinar for you. I also wanted to tell you about one more thing. I created a product called the Action Builder Cards. The Action Builder Cards contain 100 high resolution photos of many different actions and nouns paired together. And so I was finding that I was having a hard time finding material for my students. And so these cards have many different actions. So we have washing dish, we have washing hair, and we have washing hands. They're all together. So the student learns that washing doesn't just mean washing hands. It can mean many different things. So these cards help you plan for generalization, from what's going on in the therapy room to what's going on in the natural environment. So make sure to check those out on Amazon, Different Roads to Learning, and also National Autism Resources. So that's what we're going to talk about tonight. Join me next week when we talk more about manding. Have a good one.